Hi, my name is Yuri Panchin. I'm an engineer working in a company called Wave Computing, in a part of the company called MIPS. Both Wave and MIPS are located in Silicon Valley. Right now I'm working in like two offices. One is office MIPS in Santa Clara, and another is office of Wave in Campo. Let me tell you a little bit about companies and what actually I'm doing. So MIPS is a very well-known company that started back in 1978 as a project in Stanford. MIPS was started by John Hennessy, who was a young professor at Stanford at that time. And later on, he was founder of MIPS, and he is also author of probably the most popular book on computer architecture of all time, which is Computer Architecture, Qualitative Approach. Later on, John Hennessy became the president of Stanford, and MIPS became one of well-known companies which initially created processors for workstations, like for silicon graphics workstations. Those workstations were used to make early Hollywood movies with special effects, like Jurassic Park. Later on, MIPS was inside game machines, Sony PlayStation and Xbox, Nintendo 64 and Sony PlayStation. And during 21st century, MIPS was most licensed course to many other companies. If you have a wireless modem, most likely it has MIPS processor inside. So MIPS was used in cameras, in DVD players, and is now most used in LTE modems. And right now, and in places like automotive computers. For instance, a company called Mobileye is making a computer which is licensed by BMW, Volvo, and many other companies to prevent car collisions, and this embedded system uses MIPS core inside. So most recently, MIPS was acquired by a startup called Wave Computing. This startup is making neural net accelerators, and right now I'm working on neural net accelerator. So let me just show you what this neural net accelerator is. It's a device. One second. Show you the screen. Okay. Basically, this Wave neural net accelerator is a chip. It's a very large chip with billion gates, multi-billion gates that consist of very many small processor-like units. So this is like a diagram of functional unit. And there are like tens of thousands of such small processor-like functional units on this chip. And the whole thing run with a very high frequency, 6 gigahertz. Oh, one second. Can you see share screen? Oh, yes. So can you see share screen right now?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, okay. Yeah, so like basically this neural net, yeah, so this neural net accelerator is a giant multi-billion transistor chip, and it consists of like tens of thousands of small processor like elements, and so this whole thing runs with a speed of like 6 gigahertz, and each little processor inside consists of accumulator, a register file, and little local memory. So and so how this chip is used? So if any of you worked with like Google TensorFlow, you can get this Google TensorFlow converted into a special configuration which can be programmed in this chip. And the resulting chip here run neural net computation much faster, like orders of magnitude faster than you can run on a regular processor. So right now I'm sitting in the company and I do two things. So one thing is I debug existing chip, and second thing I'm working on the design of the next chip. So basically this is how my workplace in Campbell looks like. So I have two places to work, one in Campbell and another in Santa Clara. So essentially this specific photo which I took yesterday, you can see how I debug a module which you saw on the previous picture. So which is this actually cluster of 16 of such modules. So basically what I'm doing right now is a general trend what happened in Silicon Valley right now. And this trend, like John Hennessy himself, who is now on the board of Google, he made a speech like several months ago saying that a traditional history of regular processors is over, and essentially we are going into the part of history where we combine traditional processors with specialized processors like this neural net accelerators and like more well-established GPUs, graphical processors, and some special blocks. So basically, it's not enough to do programming anymore. So like people like you, you live like in the world where frequencies of traditional designs are not going to grow. Instead, like everybody who is working with computers have to think about both hardware and software at the same time, and put part of algorithms in software and part of algorithms in hardware. So even if you are not going to be a digital logic designer, even if you spend your career with computer programs, you will have to understand the basic principles of how hardware works. And essentially, right now we are going to go through some basic principles. So like after this course, you will understand what is inside those specialized chips and regular processors. So, in this chip, for those exercises, you are going to use FPGA board. So, very cheap FPGA board, which cost $30. And you can put in this FPGA board some simple designs which occupy like tens of thousand gates, like 100,000 gates. And essentially what I do The kenosis is essentially the same thing, except European people like $30 worth FPGA board, and I'm using Zebu emulator, which has many FPGAs inside, which cost hundreds of thousands of dollars. So some emulator cost like $1 million and more. And the same kind of things is used by engineers working in Intel. So they first design the processor, using Verilog and some pieces of custom logic. Then they use FPGA-based Zebu emulator. So Intel is also custom Zebu, which is made by a company called Synopsys. And then when they create prototype, they send a design to the factory. Intel uses their own factory, and Wave uses Taiwan Semiconductor factory, and a factory makes the chip. So Russia also has silicon foundries or funds called Mikron and Angstrom. They are located in the Zhilinka near Moscow, and they make some microcontrollers and some chips for space, which is one of area where Russia has unique expertise and even leadership in certain areas. So, but let's go back to basics and talk how digital design is different from software programming. So, first of all, okay, so can you hear, can you see my screen? So can you see the screen? Okay, I think you can. So okay, so like I hope you can see the screen. Good. So let's talk a little bit about terminology. So first of all, in the past circuits were designed. So during 60s, digital design principles, they actually were established long time ago, back in 1940s. And people initially were using like vacuum tubes and then individual transistors, and then they started to create integrated circuits. Initially, during the 60s, they were just drawing schematics. Then, during the 1970s, some software to convert these schematics into transistors on a plan for a chip appeared. And in the late 80s, people started to use hardware description languages. So this is language to design, simulate, and verify circuits. And for the last 30 years, majority of designers of circuits everywhere, in Intel, Apple, AMD, in our company, use hardware description languages. So and we will use Verilog 2001. People also use System Verilog and VHDL, and there is an interesting history how hardware description languages became popular. We will talk a little bit later about this. Now, RTL is a register transfer level. So this is the methodology we are going to learn in this class. So this is kind of main principle you need to learn, no matter whether you're going to be a hardware designer or a software engineer. Now, ASIC is application-specific integrated circuit. Some time ago, like 30 years ago, ASICs were considered as a specialized chips for like cell phones or for certain things. So like 25 to 30 years ago, processors and even and ASIC is a chip which is made using so-called standard cells. It's a standard set of cells that implement logic function. You can arrange them in a row and you can get ASIC. So a system on chip is a type of ASIC which has multiple processor cores, memories, and other components on the same chip. And the FPGA, field programmable gate array, is a special type of reconfigurable chip we were used to substitute making an ASIC on a FET. When you make like a chip similar to a chip which is used in like electronic gadgets, you need to pay to the factory like $1 million upfront, and then pay some small amount of money like cents or dollars for each chip. But this field programmable gate array, you can simply configure them on the fly. How it is done, we'll talk a little bit later. So, first of all, difference between hardware and software. So, hardware and software dualism. So, software and hardware are very different things. And this hardware software dualism originated back in 1940s when Eckhart, Moakley, and John von Neumann created a project called ENIAC and then EDVAC. At the same time, several other computer project starts, including Soviet project MESM. But the idea is that you have a circuit, which is a central processor unit, which gets a program, which is a chain of instructions located in memory, and it gets instruction by instruction, and each instruction is just a sequence of zeros and ones, and the processor uses those instructions to change its internal state. And when it changes internal state, it writes other values into memory or talk to input-output devices. But the difference is clear that software is a chain of instructions, and the hardware is a circuit which can execute this chain of instructions. So, in addition to processor and memory, you have other devices in your chip, including input-output controllers. And those devices, they are designed also using Verilog. Now, when you use software, first you write program in C, and then compiler translates this program into a sequence of instructions, where your loops become like chains of instructions with conditional jumps, like this one. And eventually, each instruction became just a binary number. So on the right, you can see numbers, like hexadecimal numbers that represent instructions. But the hardware is something different. When you write code in the hardware description language Verilog, it does not become like sequence of machine language instructions. Instead, it becomes circuit itself, and finally, this code becomes some transistors on the silicon chip, and connections between those transistors. So this code becomes hardware itself. Now, if code becomes hardware itself, then how can we use view programmable gate arrays? Because obviously hardware does not change inside this chip. So what you have inside the view programmable gate array is not a processor but a matrix of another can become OR, or another can become. So you can essentially use a special mechanism, a combination of PG, just like you use to construct like some raw toys. So inside the PG cell, you have multiplexer, which okay, inside the PG. To do this, you have to use much more resistors than you use in a circuit which you make in a factory. Now, digital hardware has, just like software, digital hardware design has several basic ideas. So, in software, you know that you have such ideas as like variables, ifs, loops, function calls. And in hardware, you also have basic ideas, but those ideas are different. So, those ideas include gate. Then area, size of gate, delay, which is how fast signal propagates, parallelism, which means that you can do multiple things in hardware in parallel, then module, which is a block of hardware, a test page, it's a software environment to test your design. And later on in the second lecture, we are going to talk about a so-called sequential logic, which include clock, reset, DF flip-flops, or like simplest element of memory, and power, and then the finite state machine, and the concept of pipeline. And when we do the very first lab, you will use some concepts that are shown in green, and in second lab, you are going to use concepts that are shown in blue and pink. So hardware design can be partitioned into combinational logic and sequential logic. So combinational logic is used to calculate logic and arithmetic function, and sequential logic allows hardware to have memory and to repeat actions. So the first lab will be only about combinational logic. And this is an example how you can write Verilog to implement a schematics that implements a simple combinational logic. So this module, which is a this module in Verilog describes a piece of hardware that has four inputs, two outputs, and each output depends only on its inputs. So you essentially put some signals to input, wait for some time, and then you are getting your outputs. This concept is called combinational cloud. Sequential logic is something more complicated, and we will talk about this next time. In sequential logic, your Your output of your circuit depends not only on input but also on external state, and this is synchronized by a clock signal. And without sequential logic, all you can do with your hardware is just to calculate simple mathematical functions. So, like multiplications, or if you put a lot of logic like sinus or cosinus or something which has argument and result. But with sequential logic, you can repeat hardware actions and do something interesting. So now, before we go to the lab itself, I want to show you some piece of a new book which was recently published in Russia, and publisher of this book. So this book is translated from Japanese, and this is intended for high school students, for high school students and for freshmen, sophomore students like you, to help to understand the basic concepts of digital logic. And the publisher of this book just sent this book to me for a review, and I decided to introduce this book into this lecture because it may help you. So this is how this book looks like. So it's a digital circuit design which is shown in manga. And let me show you some concepts we are going to use in this very long lab. So let me put the view slideshow. Yeah. So basically this book introduces pieces of this book introduces concept of combination and sequential logic, and the Russian translation is actually better than Japanese original because they added some additional information linking this to Babel. So basically it starts from showing how digital logic was taught back in 1970s. It was taught with this type of old-fashioned chips that have simple gates inside, those are OR gates. And this book has an explanation about AND gates, OR gates, or about NOT gate. So you basically have two input and output, and you have those gates. And it shows that during the 70s you were using fixed chips, and on the left you have kind of ASIC. And this book is saying that actually right now designers for the last 20 something years are using hardware description language Babel. And now Russian publisher of this book actually put additional chapter what is ASIC and what is FPGA. So they actually did explanation how FPGA look inside. So you can buy this book, like if you don't understand other materials, so this may help. Now in this book they are trying to build a simple combination and sequential circuit. So for instance, the simple combination circuit is a circuit that has three inputs from three different persons how to choose which restaurant to go. And they're like using buttons each of them hold, and then they finally build like this kind of circuit, so everybody has button and the circuit makes a decision which restaurant they're going. Later on in this book they are trying to optimize circuit. So they're using some optimization methods, and actually to be honest, Japanese designers in Fujitsu and later on Hideo Mitsuhiko, and they are obsessed about manual optimization. This optimization is done in most of tools right now automatically. However, the designer of this neural net chip I'm working right now, he is actually a Japanese American, and he did the design using custom logic, and which is a special manual, like high-speed logic. But he is now using HDR as well. So this book has some like interesting picture and description of how to design digital circuits using Verilog and VHDL. So this book shows, this is a sequential circuit which does another design. You talk about this design in second lecture. And this is the explanation that we have combinational circuits and sequential circuits. So combinational circuits use inputs and generates outputs, and sequential circuits also has memory, so which allow to do something more complicated. So now let's go back to this is already sequential circuit. We'll talk about sequential circuit on the next lecture. So now let's go back to our main slides. So you have FPGA boards. If you don't have FPGA boards, I would recommend you to order FPGA boards. Right now there are very cheap FPGA boards that cost just $30, and those boards are more than enough for your student exercises. So in this lab, I'm showing a FPGA board which cost $150. But if you use boards that cost $30, it doesn't matter. With your current level, you are not likely to go beyond this board. And if you create designs that does not fit this board, most likely you did something wrong. So this is a description of first lab exercise. So in first lab exercise, you will simulate a combinational module and synthesize it into FPGA. And then in homework, you can synthesize a combinational module that uses a multiplexer, this choice element. It's like hardware if statement. And you can use a 7-segment integrator to output numbers and letters. So you can get some examples from GitHub. And this example is used for right now there is a project which is led by Moscow Higher School of Economics, MIA. This group of university professors in St. Petersburg, ITMO, and in the Higher School of Economics, and in other places, they are working on the digital design lab manual. So, and those are examples which is now work in progress. So you can use it, you can take a look, and you can actually try. So you can use your work for like this book. So here is the simplest unit in hardware description language. So, unit of design is called module. Module has name. This name is bug1. Module has a list of input and output ports. So each port has a direction, and this direction is the input or output. Now, port has a size, and 1 to 0 means that this port is connected using two connectors. So you can think about them as two wires. One is key 0, and another is key 1. And this LED is just LED output. So this is a light, and those inputs and outputs can be connected to buttons and LED on your FPGA board. Now you can also define internal connectors or wires. One wire is called A, and another wire is called B. So tilde means means immersion. So wire declaration creates a connection. Note that this connection is different from software assignment. When we write in software A equal B or A equal key, it means that A equal key right now it can be reassigned. But when we create when we use this wire, this assignment is continuous, which means that any time he changes, A also changes. So every time expression on the right hand side changes, it triggers change in wire on the left hand side. So synthesis software can optimize the very wires. Now, here is another way to assign values. This assign statement means that every time expression on the right changes, like A or B changes, it changes LED number 0 or 0th bit of LED signal. Now, and this LED 1 is OR, and LED 2 is inversion of A. So we are essentially doing the same thing as in that manga text. So we are playing with AND, OR, and inversion element. So also note that those assignments do not assume a specific order. So if you change the order of this assignment, the result will be exactly the same. So so before we synthesize it for the board, we can simulate the design. And simulator is a program that runs on computer and just pretends the circuit is working. So HDR simulator is different from interpreters, like from like Python interpreter or from basic interpreter or for like Linux shell interpreter, because in HDR simulator is event driven, which means that it does not execute all text in your code one by one, but it just makes internal data structures and changes every time a certain expression changes. So, and the HDR synthesis, which is a program that converts text into schematic, creates a netlist or graph for electric circuit. Now, one important thing to do before you create chip or before you put schematics into FPGA is to simulate board. And so you need to also learn how to write test bench. So test bench is simply a program. Also, it is embedded on the system level. So, system level can be used not only to define schematics, but variable system level can also be used to create programs. And those programs work on simulator, and they just They just imitate environment your circuit is working. So in your test bench, if you go to this file, you can see a test bench which instantiates design on the test and which drives inputs and check responses. So here you can see a simulation test bench. So we create variables in the test page, and like instances of those variables that simulate external world, and then we put create instance of our circuit in a constant that look like a function called software, but actually this is just instantiates a circuit in the test bench. So if you don't understand the concept of test benches right now, don't worry, you will get it later on. It's not the priority of this lecture. And then in our test bench, you just imitate how external environment works. So how you press buttons on the FPGA board. So you have two keys, one is key 0 and key 2. And the key for binary number of two digits, 0 and 1. And first you simulate a case where you don't press both of them, then you wait for 10 time units and press one of them, then you wait for 10 more units and press another one, then you wait for 10 more units and press both of them. So, and this keyword initial in the test bench just means that this series of statements is executed at the beginning of simulation. And the begin-end is a block of statements, just like in software programming language Pascal. So, and assignment is inside here not continuous but blocking. So they are executed just like in software. So you don't need to understand test bench right now, because right now your goal is to start running the FPGA board. And on the FPGA board, it runs without the test bench. So this time scale, we can simulate it. But you can refer to these slides later on when you start to run a simulation. So you can also monitor and download control. So basically, then you create a simulation and output the result of waveforms. And hardware design engineers like me and the verification engineers as well. So I was working for a long time as a hardware verification engineer creating test benches. So now I'm also doing ASIC design, creating design itself. But both types of engineers spend a large chunk of day looking for such waveforms. Part of the day is spent on writing variable code, part of the day is spent on meetings and on discussing of how to organize everything, like architecture. But large chunk of the day is spent on looking to waveforms and figuring out what is going on with the chip. So now, when you run a simulation, you can use batch files. So you can use such batch files in Windows. And if you work under Linux, you can use shell script in Linux that run a Verilog simulator. Now, simulator itself is using another script, a script file written in tool command language TKLTK. This language is not really popular now, but this language was popular as internal language for tools back in the early 90s. So Intel, Altera, Xilinx, Synopsys, and other companies that make tools for hardware designers they use the TCL language as internal language for such tools. So scripts to run both simulation and synthesis are written using TCL, and you don't need to know TCL. All you need to know is that you can get TCL scripts, copy from somebody else, and just modify for your needs. Like this TCL script compile Verilog source and run a simulation, add to waveform, and like allow you to browse. Yeah, so this is a typical environment. This is like pretty much what I do for large chunk of the day, which is like writing Verilog code and dividing this code using waveform viewer. And if you use logic emulators like Zebu, you also can generate those waveforms. Now we will talk about converting your design into real hardware or synthesis. So how to synthesize? In order to synthesize, you are going to use a software called Quarkus. This software is created by a company called Altera, which was recently bought by Intel. And when Altera and Intel paid for Altera $17 billion. So, and when this acquisition happened, like a lot of journalists were not able to explain what Altera actually does. So they were writing some like nonsense that like Altera competes with Intel, like has their own fab. Also, Altera doesn't have their own fab. Or were writing that Altera uses makes chip for network equipment, which is not true. Also, FPGAs are used in network equipment. But Altera is doing FPGAs. So this is a chip on your FPGA boards. And there are two large FPGA companies. One is called Xilinx and another is called Altera. And now Altera is part of Intel. And Xilinx has some like annoying restrictions about shipment to Russia, the latest educational awards, and for this reason working with Altera is easier. So in order to work with Altera, you create a project file. This project file can be empty. Then you define, so a synthesis project file also uses TCL as a scripting language. So this TCL script sets what kind of device you're using, and this is a device used on one of the FPGA boards you have, and then name of the top entity, which is the top hardware block, name of your Verilog file, where you're going to put your output files. So then you need to decide to map how your signals are actually mapped to actual pins on FPGA, and which are connected to certain LEDs on FPGA board. The thing is that synthesis tool does not know that your variable key is connected to pin BA, so you need to tell it. And those names, pin BA or pin A7, they are from Altera Intel datasheet. So you can connect using this file. Now you can also specify certain electric parameters associated with the pins. And you don't need to know what those lines means. You can just copy them. They just specify that how you are going to keep electrically pins connected from FPG to outside board. Now, before synthesis, you create a copy of project file. So it's better to put to copy your project file into special directory, because synthesis produces a lot of temporary files, and you don't want to mix temporary files with your code. Now, in Intel Aquarius, you open your project. So you do open project, you find project file, then you double-click compile design. Once you compile design, it converts your code into device-independent schematics. So this schematics is the same whether you do FPGA or whether you do ASIC. And so this menu has in analysis it has like window menu has a viewer for FPGA independent schematics, so you can see that your code became this circuit which has ends and doors and nodes. So later on, another algorithm map this gates into FPGA cells. So now your logic becomes each FPGA cell. So you can see that your generic gates now became something not generic. And all those cells are located inside this chip, which is in the center of this board. This is a Jurassic G10 live board, which is inexpensive, and its academic price is $55, and it has 50,000 cells. And this is enough for a processor core. So you can actually build a lot of your own processor inside this FPGA, or you can do like other interesting circuits, like you can build some graphical circuits and so on. And now, when you synthesize, synthesis tool creates a special file, which is put in a memory associated with the chip itself. And this file you need to put into a PG using a connector called USB Blaster. So this is a short instruction how to do this using GUI. This is how to do this using GUI. So you need to click on like start if you know hardware setups, so add USB Blaster, configure for the board. Now once this design starts to work, so once you start pressing buttons and see how LED reacts, you can put your own design. So for instance, you can put here multiplexer. Multiplexer is a block of logic that allow to choose between different inputs. So you use selectors that choose either a D0 or a D1 and output something. So you can design and modify your design with a multiplexer. And also useful exercise that you can use a 7-second indicator to output numbers or letters. So you can output your name, and you can connect buttons in a way so the 7-second indicator shows either your first name or your last name. So this is kind of early exercise. Now, what we are going to see during the next lecture, we are going to go through conoscere voce. And so the guy will tell a couple more thoughts, so that you're going to be ready for sequential logic. So one important difference between hardware logic and hardware combinational logic and sequential logic is that combinational one important difference between hardware design and programming is that in hardware design, every operation takes certain time, and before operation finishes, you have some garbage on your output. So basically, your output in the intermediate state can go 1, 0, be some intermediate voltage, and you just need to wait until everything stabilizes. So in order, so before the results are ready, the output may contain random values or no, or even not digital values at all. So to find when the results are ready, we will use a special signal called clock that will tell us when our computation is ready. So this clock is the same clock you hear in a computer store when you buy a computer. And clocks can be used not only to synchronize outputs, but clocks can be used to perform iterative computations to repeat something. So we will build counter. Yeah, so this is like end of brain material. And before I finish, let me actually show you a couple more interesting things, what you can get from this from this particular thing. So if you go to Harvard, yeah, this is an article I wrote recently. On Harvard, so Intel is the same company which is making the, which has Altera. Altera was doing competitions in Asia called FPGA Asia Challenge, and people in Japan, China, Taiwan, in all Asian countries, they were competing for doing FPGA design. And now, one interesting thing is that this year Intel actually made a competition in Europe. And the funny part is that the winners of recent Intel competition in Europe were actually Russian and Ukrainian teams. So the first place was from team. So if you go to Intel, if you go to Intel FPGA event in Europe, so you can see that the first place was won by a design team from St. Petersburg. And the second place was won by two teams. One team is in Italy, and another team is in Russia as well. First team was in St. Petersburg. Later, second team was in St. Petersburg Идмоа е на 13 воз в 8 Киев. And actually, a team in St. Petersburg, they were using a PG board to create a design that uses two cameras and make HDR pictures. So they are using two pictures, one is underexposed and another is overexposed, and creating a high quality picture. So like this is a guy who a professor in Leyte who was teaching the PGs for a long time. Now this is how their design looked like. Second team was from St. Petersburg ITMO, so they created So they created a design which searches information in the network packets. So you can use it in some network router, and it will use some hashing engine to find some text. And the third was a team from Kyiv, and actually I trained them personally. So people in it was they were going to my labs in St. Petersburg, and the people in Kyiv actually won a hackathon which I was doing in Kyiv, and now winner from Russia from St. Petersburg is now coming to Santa Clara, so he is supposed to be here right now. Actually, probably need to contact him. So winners of European competition are coming to Santa Clara, and essentially you can do same thing by yourself because you have also tools. You have a PGA board, and you can see that actually Russian and Ukrainian teams they didn't use they were using PGAs recently. Some of them just started. The people in Ukraine, they were not taking part in FPGA competitions before, so they started, they like already won bronze. So in principle, you can do the same kind of things, and you can do to this Intel innovative FPGA and get some ideas about what kind of designs you can do. And some of those designs, like high schoolers can do. Like this is a girl who from ninth grade who was in Novosibirsk summer school of young programmers. So she was added an instruction to a one cycle processor, so this is something you can do in one of like last labs. So you can see that you can do all those exercises. You can win competitions in Europe, or maybe come to the final here to Santa Clara. This type of exercises of labs can help you to understand how hardware works, and in the future you can use those labs to create. So you can use those skills to create systems that have both software and hardware. Yeah. So let me start this video. This is useful. Yeah, so this is like a ninth grade school girl from video. So this first ninth grade boy who created a music device using FPGA, using the same FPGA board. So he's using a state machine, and you can see very low code. So he's using the same type of FPGA board. And then, okay, let's see, was it he showing? Yeah, so they made presentation in the, yeah. And this is Gill about processor design. So one interesting thing is that actually what this Gill is doing is practically same thing like we are doing here in Santa Clara. So like right now one of my tasks is to add some number of instructions. So in addition to a neural net device, I'm also working on a processor which is called MIPS i64500. First has code name Samurai and second has code name Daimyo. Like I'm also working on the processor i7200 with code name Xiaomi. So, but in Daimyo, I was adding some instructions by modifying instruction decoding and execution. And this girl is doing essentially the same, but in 9th grade, so she added instruction to a small processor and she modified decoding of execution. So the difference is that this processor girl is using is like 300 lines of Verilog, but our Daimyo processor is 300,000 lines of Verilog. So our code is 1,000 times larger. But the principles are pretty much the same. So you can learn these principles with small processor, and then you can do complicated processors. So you can see this Verilog code, and later on in the course, you can do exercise with the same type of processor. Yeah. So I think this is pretty much close to end of the lecture, right? So you can ask some questions. Okay. So now. I stop sharing, so...
First of all, thank you so much for a very nice tutorial. So, did you have any question about? I know it's a little bit hard, but maybe some question. I think no questions, but let's give a big hand. But before that, you know what time is now? Because we asked Yuri for this panel around 2 a.m. in California, and he was like awake for us to give this nice tutorial. And we are very thankful that we have Yuri with us on board. And the good thing that we have the devices, we have these FPGA boards, and we can also participate in some of the competitions, and we can also win. So this is also a big motivation for us. So thank you so much, Yuri. Give a big hand to you. Okay, thank you so much, Yuri. So it's very late, and I hope we will catch you next week.
Okay. So see you next week.
Okay, thank you so much. Bye.
Okay, bye-bye.